couple of announcements for us this morning as we begin to worship. It. Once again, the board met last Monday night and called Pastor Peter Utek to be our pastor. So please keep Pastor Utek in your prayers as he once again considers a call here to Bethesda. This week, this Wednesday, is Ash Wednesday. You all know that's the beginning of Lent. This year it is called Cross Peace, our Lenten series. And if you notice, as you came in, there was a little cross on the table back there with objects on it. That will be our focus for our Lenten services, midweek Lenten services. Everybody, every member, every family will get a cross. Then each week, you'll get an item that goes with that cross. A stone, a dice, a money bag, no money. A money bag, a sponge. Those little items each week will be the focus of our meditation for that week. So plan on coming. You'll pick up your cross in the first object Wednesday evening, 7 o'clock. This morning is new member reception as well. We have a few that are with us to stay. So we'll participate in that in the middle of the service. Also, today is Valentine's Day. I see some of you in red. I don't know why, but that's been awesome. Anyway, Valentine's Day, and the youth have prepared for you a Valentine's breakfast, brunch, however you want to put it. Sausage and biscuits and all types of goodies and so forth. And they said, if you don't, come and get it today. You'll get it Wednesday, and then next Sunday. So even if you did not sign up, go down to the fellowship hall after services and enjoy some biscuits and gravy and other goodies that the youth have prepared for us. Last week, we had our children from the school singing, and one of the songs that they sang was Amazing Love. And I know it was hard for you to hear. We only had a few here, but you get an opportunity to hear again today, as well as sing. Our youth are in the balcony, and they're going to lead us. They're all standing up out there and waving. They're going to lead us in singing Amazing Love, and it is on the insert in your worship folder. Amazing Love. Any announcements? Yes. Soup supper this Wednesday, chili and ham and potato, and there's a sign up back there so you know how much to prepare.
Yep.
So please do that. That's Wednesday, actually Wednesday, 5:30. Beginning at 5:30. That's where I announced, so it's going to be 5:30. Any other announcements? Yes.
You were
ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of the work of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
We continue in intro, reading responsibly, half verse by half verse. Exalt the Lord our God, and worship at his holy mountain.
The Lord our God is holy.
The Lord reigns. Let the people tremble.
He sits enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth quake.
The Lord is great in Zion.
He is exalted over all the peoples.
Let them praise your great and awesome name.
Holy is he.
The king in his might loves justice.
You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool.
Holy is he.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Exalt to the Lord our God, and worship at his holy mountain.
The Lord our God is holy.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Mercy.
For the peace from above and for us. down from the mountain. Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. Aaron and all the people of Israel saw Moses, and behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses talked with them. Afterward, all the people of Israel came near, and he commanded them all that the Lord had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil over his face. Whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would remove the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the people of Israel what he was commanded, the people of Israel would see the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face was shining. And Moses would put the veil over his face again until he went in to speak with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson from 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold. Not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened. For to this day, when they read the old covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. But we have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word, but by an open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled only to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. White, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated for the hymn. It is good, Lord, to be here. Hymn 414. Here's our sin. Peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, may we see the light of your face in all of its glory as we come into your house and into your word, knowing that you have provided for us salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In whose name we pray. Amen. Today we transfiguration. We look at a mountaintop experience. And most of us have had some type of mountaintop experience in our life. There are times when maybe you experience some great feelings of excitement, euphoria, or closeness that you just didn't want it to end. Some of you may have attended a gathering of a large number of Christians somewhere, such maybe as a synodical LWML convention, or even a synodical convention or youth gathering where there were great speakers, tremendous, tremendous music, camaraderie, praying, sharing. And maybe you thought, oh, it would just be a great thing, a joy to stay here. Most of us can relate to that in some manner. Maybe a special vacation, birth of a child, your wedding day, mountaintop experience. We've had all of those kind of defining moments that we remember and we look back to across the landscape, you might say, of our lives to those mountains, literal or figurative. And that shows us really where we've been and to some extent who we are and where we're going. Perhaps today in our gospel lesson, the story, the lesson started out maybe just like any other day for the disciples. They were with Jesus, going along the pathway, going to proclaim the good news of salvation that has come into the world. But it was going to turn out to be a day that they would never forget, ever. Jesus called Peter, James, and John, the inner circle of favorite, you might say. He often went apart to pray and would take them with him. And prayer time was all they were really expecting. We're going with Jesus. Up and up and up, up the mountain they went until they reached the top. And there they stopped. Luke's gospel says that Jesus began to pray. He also tells us that the three disciples became very sleepy. Peter, James, and John were not expecting what came next. While they watched in awe, something wonderful beyond description, Riddick, began to happen. The kindly face of that Galilean carpenter began to change in a way that the evangelist had found difficult to describe. Later, the three men tried to find words just to express what they had seen. Light streamed from his face, as bright as the sun. His clothes became whiter than white. They shone with light. These men knew Jesus well. They'd been with him 3 years. They'd heard him speak. They saw him heal people, raise the dead. They even confessed their faith finally that he was the Son of God, the Messiah. They were not prepared for the display of this dazzling glory that they saw. They knew Jesus. But they realized at that point, I think, they hardly knew him at all. Then as they watched, the three disciples became aware that there are two other people there. Two others talking with the Jesus in this cloud of light. The same mysterious and wonderful way they knew that these two glorious figures were Moses, the lawgiver, and Elijah, the Old Testament prophet. Moses, on a mountaintop long before that, this great giant of the faith, one of meekness as well, had talked with God face to face. And he received at that point the Ten Commandments, the holy law of God, which all mankind is supposed to live, but especially the people of God. Those whom God had separated for himself, he now gave them his law. Elijah, on another mountain, years later, but still a long time before this happening, this prophet down from heaven, wiped out those prophets of Baal, and brought God's people back to him. Mountaintop experiences. Luke tells us something about Moses and Elijah were discussing when their glorious Lord made that mountaintop day for them. They were talking about another mountain that was to be climbed. They were talking about a hill we call Calvary. Peter, James, and John may not have understood the full implication in that dazzling light of the moment, but they were dramatically seeing portrayed before their very eyes two things. One, Jesus as fulfilling the law, Moses, completing the truth of the Torah. And two, Jesus as the champion of evil, Elijah, making sinners right with God, completing the plan of salvation. But the disciples were uncomfortable. Now, don't ever think that when God is manifested in power, it is comfortable, and it's going to be an easy time, maybe. This was a gut-wrenching experience for them. It was frightening to the limit. They said, the text says that they were terrified. Peter, who always has something to say, began to talk. Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up three shelters, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for you. Didn't know what he was saying, but he had to say something. And then came a majestic, thundering, authoritative voice from heaven. You know, the Father always puts things into perspective. And he said, this is my beloved Son. Listen to him. Listen to him. The heart of faith is not Jesus and the law. It's not Jesus and proclamation or Jesus and anything else. The heart of faith is Jesus. That's the message of this mountaintop experience carried home by Peter, James, and John. Jesus. Then it was over. Boom. Just like that. Moses and Elijah was gone. Everything seemed to be back to normal. And he began to come down the mountaintop. But even before they got to the bottom, they were back to the nitty-gritty work of proclaiming the gospel. And as far as I know, as far as anybody knows, they never had another mountaintop experience such as that, the transfiguration moment. But these men never forgot what they saw on that mountain that day. They needed that as well. For just a short time later, their master was taken from them. He was mocked, spit upon, beaten, forced to carry his cross to that mountain outside Jerusalem, where he was killed, hanging on the cross, innocent. It looked like defeat. It looked like weakness. But they'd been to the mountain. They had seen the glory. And they could really believe it then when the resurrection took place. This is the Christ, the Son of the living God. The one who paid the price for you and for me. The price of sin on that mountain outside of Jerusalem where he died. God accepted that. The Father accepted that. And he forgives. And we have life everlasting. Peter, James, and John and the rest of the disciples really needed that assurance after Jesus ascended into heaven. For then they began to carry their own crosses. And they were heavy crosses. And they were tempted, I'm sure. Is it really worth it? The answer is yes. They had seen the glimpse of glory. They knew that their master was the Lord of Moses, the Lord of Elijah, the Lord of everything. And he was alive. They went to the mountain. They could trust that God would not waste their sacrifice. James was killed by the sword. Early in the Peter led the church in Jerusalem, and then Antioch, and Ephesus, and Rome. And he was martyred as well. The vision sustained him through all of that, and he passes it on to Luke. John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, outlived them all, died a natural death. But as long as he lived, the memory of that day of the transfiguration on a mountain in the north of Israel was a blessing and a force. And he passed it on. And we hear it today. We can't live on mountaintops. We can't even live for that kind of experience that those disciples had. But don't forget, 8 perfectly good apostles got word of that day, that event, secondhand as well. Just like you, just like me. What we can do is live in confession of faith in our Lord and Savior who was transfigured. If truly the faith has been granted us to believe that Jesus is the Christ, then we can say with Peter and John that this glorious event of the transfiguration, that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. But that's who he is. What we can do if we have faith is to affirm from our hearts that Jesus is Lord. We can ask him if we can follow him around day after day, and we do that when we listen, as the Father said, listen to him. When we hear his word, when we read his word, when we meditate on his word, when we take it to heart, we have that mountaintop experience, even though we may not be on the mountain. And we can take that out to the world. And we can share that with other people. We can take it to a hurting world, a world out there that, well, the majority of people do not know Christ. The more majority of people are going to hell. And that we have the message of eternal hope in Christ Jesus. Our mountaintop experience is yet to come. And we pray, come, Lord Jesus, come soon. But while we wait, and while we have patience, and while we proclaim that word, then we can look forward to having that mountaintop experience where we will see the light of Christ and its truth there in the heaven that he's preparing for us. May we have many experiences of telling the joy of Christ to others. That's what we can do while we wait. And sometime, when we least expect it, there will be those loving times in our life, those tender times when Jesus lets us know, you're doing okay. Continue the work I gave you to do. Tell others what I've done for them. Have that mountaintop experience daily, if you wish. Have that moment where you share Christ with others to give them experience of knowing that God loves them, that their sins are paid for, salvation is theirs. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. As I said before, we have a reception of new members. We are to do this anytime we have members coming in by confirmation or affirmation or transfer and so forth. So I ask our new members to please step forward. Now, I'm going to ask them a bunch of questions. And they're going to respond. But I want you all to listen to those questions as well. And you can respond as well. For we are the members of the body of Christ here. And we need to remind ourselves from time to time what Christ has called us to do and to be. So, as you all gather here, I ask you, beloved Lord, Lord Jesus Christ said to his apostles, whoever confesses me before men, I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Lift up your hearts, therefore, to God, the God of all grace, and joyfully give answer to what I now ask you in the name of the Lord. Do you this day, in the presence of God and of this congregation, acknowledge the gifts that God gave you in your baptism? So answer, yes, I do.
Yes, I
do. Do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways? So answer, yes, I renounce them.
Yes, I renounce them.
Do you believe in God? God the Father Almighty, in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit, so answer, yes, I believe in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yes, I believe in God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Do you hold all the prophetic and apostolic scriptures to be the inspired word of God, and the doctrine of the evangelical Lutheran Church drawn from them and confessed in the small catechism to be faithful and true? So answer, I do. Do you intend to hear the word of God and receive the Lord's Supper faithfully? So answer, I do, by the grace of God. Do you intend to live according to the word of God, and in faith, word, and deed, to remain true to God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, even to death? So answer, I do, by the grace of God. Do you desire to become a member of this congregation? So answer, I do. Will you support the work of our gracious Lord that he has given to this congregation with your prayers and the gifts God has given you? So answer, I will, with the help of God.
I will.
Upon this, your confession of faith, I acknowledge publicly that you are members of the Evangelical Lutheran Church and of this congregation. Receive the Lord's Supper and participate with us in all the blessings of salvation that our Lord Jesus has given to his church. In the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for your great goodness in bringing these, your sons and daughters, to the knowledge of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and enabling them both with the heart to believe and with the mouth to confess his saving name. Grant that by your word and spirit, they may continue steadfast in the one true faith, in the fellowship of this congregation, as together we await the day when all who have fought the good fight of faith shall receive the crown of righteousness through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. And if you would just turn around. Now, most of you have seen all these people before, but in case you don't know, this is Pastor Dan and Patty Feiner. I'll never spell it right, but I hope they'll pronounce it right one of these days. These guys here and over there, you've seen for quite a while, Larry and Rose Mason. They've been here how long? Not quite a year, about a year, maybe? Okay. And these two right here, Jeff and Rosalina Sandow. You know, I always pronounce that right. About September, wasn't it? September, something like that. They just came in. I want you all to welcome them, to greet them, talk with them, show them the love of Christ. Please stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, you revealed your glory in the transfiguration of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who tabernacled among us in the flesh. Open our eyes of faith that we would see him continuing to tabernacle among us here in the divine service, and that we would heed your admonition to listen to him as he forgives and preserves us at the font, pulpit, and the altar. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Holy Father, the appearance of Moses and Elijah at our Lord's glorious transfiguration, you reveal to us that all the law and the prophets are fulfilled in him. Send your blessing upon all pastors and servants of your church, that all their preaching and teaching which flow from the right understanding, that all Holy Scripture testifies of Christ, that all that he has done and continues to do for our eternal salvation is fulfilled. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we ask that you also be with Pastor Utek as he considers the call to serve here as the shepherd of the sheep here at Bethesda. Bless his meditation upon your word. Bless his contemplation upon the call. And we thank you, Lord God, that you have called him to be a servant in your church. So we ask that you place him where you desire him to serve your people. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious Father, from whom Christian home, that husbands and wives would be devoted to one another, and parents would pass on the faith to their children by word and deed. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty Father, you alone establish all authority on earth. Bless those entrusted with this responsibility, both here and abroad, that they would serve with integrity and honor for the well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy. Mercifully, Father, graciously comfort and strengthen those who are sick, hospitalized, or enduring ongoing treatment. We pray this day for Marianne Allen, Kathy Mills, Arlene Thomas, David Merrill, Marilyn Kaiser, Halzer, Dennis Cox, Ben Stombaugh, that they would know your peace and receive healing and relief according to your gracious will. Be with those who are lonely, depressed, or mentally ill. Surround them with those who know your redeeming love and will mercifully care for them. Grant steadfastness to those near death, comfort to those who grieve, and assure the certain hope of the resurrection to all your children. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, we pray for the families of Bethesda, that you would send your spirit to watch over them, protect them, guide and lead them to a deeper love for you and for your work here on this earth, that we may truly be the body of Christ working together for the good of your kingdom. We pray this week for Galen and Lori and Chance and Charity Bethane. Grant them your peace, Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, how lovely is the dwelling place of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who gives us sinners to eat and drink of his flesh and blood here at the holy altar. Grant to all who come to this feast today, repentant and believing hearts, that in the blessed sacrament they would receive forgiveness, life, and salvation, and be strengthened in their faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember on this day the glorious manifestation of your Son's divinity on the Mount of Transfiguration. Teach us to listen to Jesus and to ever fix our eyes on him and his innocent suffering and death for our forgiveness. By your grace and mercy, strengthen us to remain faithful in all circumstances of trial, temptation, and persecution. Preserve us to the end that we may die a blessed death, believing in your beloved Son, with whom you are well pleased, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We confess together the Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us in and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. The offering will be received. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank thank you for all the blessings of life, the blessings of eternal life that you gained for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. We bring to you, Heavenly Father, an offering of that which you have given to us. May we use it to your honor and glory for the furtherance of your kingdom, the work here at Bethesda and worldwide. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you, and in fervent love toward one another, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you in favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated for the closing hymn. 411, I Want to Walk as a Child of the Light. Stuff. Terry said, you know, the youth are overstanding and sanding. Let's see, who did I miss? Carrie. Miss Carrie. She caught little strips and did a marvelous job. I have to, you know, build up my knees. Sure Christ this week.